like to first thank the 150th St. Albans Raid Committee for inviting me here tonight. The reason I'm here is next year is the 150th anniversary of the St. Albans Raid, and to commemorate that event, they are putting together some fantastic, a fantastic weekend full of events, which include Civil War encampment, an actual reenactment of the raid, and they're also hoping that people will come to the reenactment in period dress. They're also going to host a women's tea and a ball, all of which people could come in period-appropriate clothing. So we would really like to encourage that, and so therefore I am here to talk about what is period-appropriate clothing, and hopefully we'll have some fun. I don't intend this to be a stuffy history lesson. So what I'm going to talk about are pretty much what is the most common. There are no absolutes, but there were things, trends that people followed that, you know, when you look at period photographs, that you will see of 100 photographs, most women were wearing X or most men were wearing Y. And so those are the type of things I'm going to cover, and that will ensure that if you do choose to dress for any of these events, that you will know what you're looking for. Victorian times, the rule is conformity. People wanted to look alike. They didn't want to stand out. They didn't want to be different. They wanted to look like everybody else. And to do something outside of the norm could actually be like social suicide. So the idea was people wanted to have the same look. And there were also a lot of social expectations around dress. There are clothing that's specific to age. There's clothing specific to your social status. There's clothing specific to the time of day, depending on your social status. So I can't get into all of that, but I will point out some of those differences, and particularly between what you would wear to, say, the St. Albans Raid reenactment versus the ball, there is a pretty big difference. But as a rule of thumb, Victorians were, you know, cleanliness was next to godliness. That was a, you know, kind of a standard rule, and the idea was, regardless of your social status, to be clean and neatly dressed as you could for your economic situation was expected. But even though people tried to conform and that they would, you know, try to be as neat and clean as they can, it didn't mean that poor people were expected to try to dress up to the next class. They did try to, you know, people would always try to move up in class, and they would try to represent that through their clothing. But a poor person to go out and buy the finest silk dress would be looked down upon because that would be considered frivolous. Many women who can lay no claim to a beautiful face have carried captive the hearts of plenty of men by the beauty of their form. You will often hear men say of such and such a girl, "To be sure, she has not a beautiful face, but then she has the most exquisite form." And this they speak with such peculiar earnestness that it is quite evident that they mean what they say. And this is something, this book is actually pretty funny. But this is something that women really took to heart. The silhouette of the Civil War era is something the women strove for. They were conformists, and they wanted to, I'm going to have to take this off so I can show you the mannequins. And I'm going to point out the difference here between these dresses to kind of illustrate what I'm talking about. And then once I do this, I'm hoping one way when you're thinking about what you might want to wear for the St. Albans Raid event, best way to kind of get yourself familiar with the clothing is to start looking at photographs. until I actually started learning about clothing and putting it on myself, I didn't really, when I was looking at the photographs before, I didn't really know what I was looking at. You look at the photo in totality rather than looking at the details of what they're actually wearing. So I'm hoping after I go through some of this that you, when you look at the photographs, you'll be able to see the differences in what I'm talking about. What I have up here, these are both antique dresses from the era. And this woman in the black dress here, this woman would have been of like middle to maybe upper middle class status. This woman in the cotton dress, this is probably lower middle class to possibly a poor woman's best dress. And one thing to keep in mind, there's no hard line. So one woman's work dress, worst dress, might be another, a poor woman's best dress. So the differences here from the class perspective is, first is the material, and this will be, this will carry forward to the men's too. The finer materials were expensive, and people didn't have closets full of clothing. Clothing was expensive. These dresses probably take 7 to 8 yards of material. So to buy silk, silk was expensive, and that's what this dress is made out of. Whereas cotton was a lot easier to acquire, it was cheaper. We were mass producing it here in the United States. So proportionately, their waists are going to be smaller than mine, you know, even if we had the same, you know, body fat level. They were just smaller, you know, the nutrition was different. So anybody that gets, you know, if you corset, don't be dismayed if you're not 21-inch waist. If you're in a hoop, you're not going to be cooking around a fire. And it is difficult to move. Getting into a carriage would have been difficult. Sitting is not so difficult once you learn how to sit. Women, if any of you get a hoop, haven't worn a hoop, I recommend you put your hoop on before you go out in public. The idea that if I just sat down now, it's going to push the hoops forward, which is how they would end up flying up. So what you have to do is lift the hoop that's just below your bottom up, and you sit in between the hoops, and then you're fine. I gotta suck it in. It's tough, the first one I do of the year. I'm only going to put one on for now, just for time purposes. You can get flounced petticoats, which is like having two in one, because you would have, you know, the extra layers on. Good idea to jump up and down, make sure it gets over your entire skirt. My dress. This is a cotton dress, so that's why I'm saying this is more of a middle class. This is going to be my best dress, but it's cotton, so that means I'm not affording silk just yet, but it doesn't mean it's not pretty. When most people see me at reenactments in this dress, they think, you know, I must be a rich person. And I'm like, I'm not. One thing I want to point out are the sleeves. Again, big sleeves, but this is a different shape. This is a pagoda sleeve. And this was really popular for like a woman's tea or evening wear. This kind of sleeve came into fashion in the end of the 1850s, but it did continue on into the 1860s. And one thing too, if you're looking at dresses and patterns, it's not inappropriate to wear late 1850s clothing. Older women tend to hang on to their fashion longer, and it's, you know, like I said, it's expensive. This is a 7 or 8 yard of material. You know, if they didn't have any reason to get rid of their dress, they didn't. I mean, they were practical. So one thing I want to point out is that the skirt you see is not stretched over my hoop like a lampshade. That would be incorrect. So you just want to make sure, that's why it's important to know how big your hoop is if you're going to wear one. So that it's, if it was stretched out, it's going to look odd. You can see both of these ladies have some nice little folds in their dresses. It should lay elegantly over the hoop, not be stretched. Traveling suit. And this came into popularity towards the end of, like the mid to the end of the 1860s. This was actually an 1864 pattern, which is appropriate for the St. Albans Rape. Women's jackets were called basques. They had a lot of different terminology than what we use today. You can see there's the peplum in the back. In the wedding hoop is much more bell-shaped, and you'll see the hoop I have is starting to get a little poof in the back. And what happens to hoops, as we head through the 1860s, the hoop starts to getting more oblong and pushing out towards the back, and the dresses will get flatter in the front. By the 1870s, you'll see straight skirts of the bustle era. So that was the moving to that, and these basques with the peplums was starting to support that because this would sit nicely over the back of a small bustle. But you'll see this has a V-neck, not so good for the day, but what they did wear, just like my fake sleeves, they would have like a little dicky type of thing. This is called a chemisette. And I would wear this under that jacket with probably matching sleeves, or sometimes it wasn't necessarily just a sleeve, it could just be a cuff. And that would go under that. And this would be day wear, travel wear. Most you will see are one-piece dresses. But when you look through any of my books, and I have several books over there that are just loaded with reprints of original photographs, you will see women that have a separate top from bottom. So there were separates, and if you don't have a big budget for these events, the separates sometimes could be an economical way to have a period look. So I could do something like this. This is a boned bodice, but it's appropriate, and you see it has the big sleeves and the small waist, and it's darted in the front. There were blouses too. They didn't call them blouses. Garibaldi waist, and you see it's wider. It doesn't have the darts. Typically, you would see younger adults wear this in late teens, and with a separate skirt. But a lot of times, they would wear it with a belt, and so it would. And this would also be good to cover you know, the fact that it's not a one-piece dress. And if you got a skirt, oh, I didn't mention, the skirts are always on a waistband. They didn't have, you'll see a lot of skirts on, if you look online, particularly on eBay, your cheapest ones are going to be like my like the wedding skirt, it's like a cinch waist, and you know, it's a drawstring, and it's, you know, one size fits all, which won't look right. But they did have belts. A belt like this would be worn by a younger woman, but you'll see in those photographs, there's a lot of women that just wore a belt like this, which could cover the fact that you don't have a waistband if you're going to wear a separate skirt and blouse. So that's another thing that you could do to cut corners. I had mentioned indoor, this is a day cap. I would wear this indoors mostly. A lot of women didn't even wear a cap. I do because I have short hair. And I see a lot of women in the room here with short hair. And so this is my cover for short hair. but it's not inappropriate either. You can wear a cap. If you were out though, you're gonna wear a bonnet. And a bonnet was the most common form of headwear. And one thing is to keep in mind if you're looking for your own bonnet, the bonnets did not come for, the bonnets of this era were really not going to cover me from, you know, protect me from the sun. They sit too far back on your head. It was really just for looks. But there is a bonnet that was particularly for sun, and it was a work bonnet. This is called a slap bonnet, and this is something that that woman in the cotton dress might be wearing if she's out in her garden. And this was for sun protection. This is the only clothing item I have that would help give you your milky white skin. That was part of the ideal beauty. Other than that, my sun protection is going to come from my parasols if I'm outside. And they, if you had the money to have one, you would. But this would not necessarily be, this slat bonnet would not necessarily be an inappropriate bonnet for a poor or a lower middle class woman to wear if she's going to the market in St. Albans when the raid happens.
So did women wear bonnets to the ball?
Yeah. Many women didn't wear anything on their head, but the hairstyles of the time, they had long hair tied, you know, pulled back tightly in like a bun or of some type of bun. And typically the older women, which I would be considered older, although that pains me to say, the bun would sit right at the nape of the neck, and younger women tend to wear it down here. And so that's one thing that I do wear. I wear a hairpiece because these don't sit on your head right without it. If I didn't have that on, this would come way forward and it wouldn't be correct. Some of the bonnets you might find online are actually designed to sit on a big hairstyle in the back. So just watch what you get. And if you buy something and it keeps flopping over and it doesn't sit on your head right, it's probably because it's expecting a bun. For a ball, they would put flowers in their hair. Older women could start wearing their hair down a little bit, ringlets in the front. Still pretty much mostly up, but they would have some hair coming down. This is a headpiece that they could wear. Flowers, a little bit of lace, ribbons were big. They might braid something like this into their hair. And they could wear just like a little cap on top too. But even just natural flowers, silk flowers, whatever you want to stick in there. Hats were just coming into fashion about this time period of the raid. Younger women would latch on to the newer fashions faster than older women, same thing as today. So you'll see in photographs younger women typically wearing hats, but like I said, nothing's 100% absolute. There are older women that wore hats. The hats were typically shallow, and there was a curve to them. That I'm dramatizing it, but they were typically like that. This is pretty much like a blank. They would not have typically worn it like that. They like this. They want the feathers and the bows and the lace and that type. But you want to be careful to not overdo it for the dress that, you know, that woman would not wear this bonnet. She would wear something a little more simple. This is an actual period hat, and you can see it's very small, but this is an adult woman's hat. For a younger adult, again, they would wear this forward on their head. Same thing that pillbox hats were also popular, but don't wear them back like Jackie O, wear them in the front. So they would be typically tilted down towards the front. It's pretty, if you can find a nice hat, it's pretty easy to decorate them yourselves with ostrich plumes, silk flowers. Just think, you know, natural materials though. Polyester didn't exist. So it's real easy to decorate a hat with a with a feather and a flower. Also, this color scheme might seem a little obnoxious, but the Victorians did not get all matchy-matchy. This is kind of matchy-matchy, but I might throw on a purple belt or change up into a purple bonnet, and that would not be inappropriate. So look at, if you look at period patterns, material and wallpaper, you can see their color combinations, fuchsia and brown and lime green and, you know, electric blue. They like their color. This is Mackenzie. Doesn't she look beautiful?
Yeah.
Yes.
So, children in the Victorian times were dressed like miniature adults. So you will see that many similarities in the way she's dressed to the way I'm dressed. But there are some differences. You can see she does have a fuller skirt, and she has the dark boots, rounded toe. But one thing you notice is the skirt's shorter. That is common for children, just, you know, because they like to play. boys, young, toddler boys and girls would both wear dresses. And the common hairstyle for, oh, how pretty you are. Boys and girls would have short hair. Girls was typically, would have like a cropped haircut, you know, maybe to the shoulders. Boys would have short. When you look at the toddler, sometimes you can't tell the difference. The only way you can really tell a difference is you look at the part, because women and girls always, almost always, parted their hair in the middle, and men and boys parted their hair on the sides. So you can tell the difference between the toddler boys and the toddler girls in dresses by their hair parts. So Mackenzie is actually, she's wearing a hoop, which isn't really totally accurate for children. There were hoops, but most kids like to play and run around, and a hoop isn't that easy to do, to run around in. They would most likely wear multiple petticoats to get that same look. The other thing that's different about Mackenzie's dress and mine, other than it being shorter, is hers buttons in the back. Because younger children would be dressed by their parents, so her dress is buttoned in the back. She also has short sleeves on and the boat neck, so her look is more like a woman's evening dress. So she would have the boat neck and the short sleeves, and it was okay for kids to show their arms. And this was true for even teenage girls. The mom would typically determine when a girl was going to be the woman. 16, 17, things might start changing. Mackenzie is not wearing a corset, obviously, but they did have corsets for kids. And I was just talking to someone earlier before we started up again. Children's corsets were called stays. They would look similar to mine, less boning, softer, and they had shoulder straps. As Mackenzie, once she would be about preteen age, she would start corseting. And so when you're corseting and you're still growing, you grow into your corset, which also contributed to the smaller waists of the time. Their bodies grew differently, and there were medical studies that were against corsets in general, but particularly tight corseting, because it, you know, moves your body organs in different places and you grow differently. But to Mackenzie's age, she might be wearing stays, she might not. That would be up to the mom. Here today, he is dressed similar to what maybe a rural farmer might wear. Not in the field plowing necessarily, but he's coming to town to pick up items or, you know, go to the market and whatnot. Men's clothing, like I said at the very beginning, it barely changed for decades. It moved so slow. And it's actually, I mean, it's kind of funny because I think men's clothing is like that today. women's clothing changed by the month. And I have like Peterson's magazines and Gotti's lady books. Those were like the vogue of the day. That's where women got their fashion information. That was high style, high fashion, you know, maybe not practical for everybody, but they would get ideas from what the women would wear. Men's fashion creeped along at minute speeds. You can see it's not buttoned all the way down. So they were only, they only buttoned about halfway down, and that is really common. You see, he doesn't really have a collar. This is typical of a workman's shirt. It's a little nicer quality. He does have a pocket, and it's a nicer, it has nicer buttons, and it's a good quality cotton. But he would work in this. He is a St. Albans native, sort of?
Close.
Close.
40 years.
Okay, that's good though. So Jim is dressed in an outfit that is appropriate for maybe middle to upper class, depending on the quality of his material. And the differences you'll see, one is he's wearing a vest or a waistcoat. And most men didn't think that they were dressed without wearing a waistcoat. You would see even farmers with waistcoats. Bob's representing one that's just starting out, so he's having hitting tough times. He doesn't have his waistcoat on yet, but we have one for him. Jim also had similar pants to what Bob's wearing, only his are a lightweight wool. He's wearing his waistcoat. He's got a collared shirt with a tie. Men's ties came in all different shapes and sizes. So the bow tie was very popular, but there were longer bow ties. There were bow ties that looked like ribbons. They were big, giant cravats like this that would go around a high-collared shirt. It would wrap around twice, and they'd tie it in like a big, giant bow. So there was a lot of variety in the ties. The shirt, though, you'll see, other than the fact that there's a collar on it, is very similar to what Bob's wearing. It doesn't button all the way down. This shirt, it has big puffy sleeves like the women's. That shirt style is nearly the same style of shirt as existed in the Revolutionary War. The difference is, in the Revolutionary War, they tied up the front rather than having the buttons, but the style itself is nearly identical. And this, you know, drop shoulders and everything. But Jim has his coat. This is called a frock coat. So it's longer. It's a little more formal. Again, it could come in varying degrees of quality of material. He might, if he was going to upgrade his coat, he might have like a velvet lapel. And for headwear, I didn't mention, Bob's got his straw hat. Straw hats were very common. Wide brim, good for someone who's going to be working outdoors. Jim has a short top hat on. But Jim also has a tall straw top hat, and this would be very formal wear for the summertime, and just because it's straw doesn't mean it's lower quality or lower class. The governor of Vermont wore a straw top hat. But this would be a common hat that would be worn by a laborer or a workman. Teenage boys would wear this a lot too. But that hat is not go with this bottom here. Just so you know. That hat would go better with Bob's outfit. You want to? Yeah. So let me see. The only extra thing Jim has that Bob's not wearing is he's got his pocket watch. Pocket watches were very common. There were no wrist watches. So men that had watches, they would have been a pocket watch. And that one works. His agricultural pursuits to the point where he can now afford a waistcoat. And we might even trade in this hat. fit his head because this is a real one and it's like fits a peanut head. A bowler hat. And this is a very popular hat for with young men and older men alike. But the more elderly men coming through the 1850s, top hats were like, that was it. And so Bob most likely wouldn't wear a top hat with that coat. I want to give you that back. And you want to take off your coat. This is a frock coat that is similar to what Jim's wearing. Again, you probably can't really tell the difference by looking at it. Jim's coat's a little finer wool than what Bob has on, but I mean, he looks better already, doesn't he? So now he's getting a little more formal. The thing is he's missing his collar. But luckily for Bob, men had separate collars too. Now this is going to be, we're not going to put this on because I think it's going to be hard. But you can get the idea. There's a button on the back of his shirt that would button the back of this collar. And the collar would come around. And this would be a straight stand-up collar. And then he could put his tie on. And as I mentioned, you know, there was different types of ties. And if Bob really wants to class it up, he's going to put on his top hat.
Nice. Mr. President.
Yeah. And now Bob is probably is dressed to the level that would be appropriate for my spouse. We would not be, and a woman would actually dress to, you know, appropriate to her spouse. She would not dress better than her spouse or less than her spouse. Pants were wool and they're itchy and they weren't necessarily lined. When you go see the reenactors, understand that they're doing this in the summer and they're wearing wool uniform that is not lined in the sun, running around with their guns and dragging their cannons and all that. The only thing that protected the men from the wool were their drawers, and this is a pair of men's drawers. And you would think, well, geez, you know, they're wearing all this material underneath pants, and it must have been pretty bunchy, but when you consider the alternative is you're sweating on wool, this was a savior for them.